I want to start by asking you a question which I'm sure you get asked a lot, and it's about how you present yourself and how you look. Because when I'm sitting here looking at you, you have a very defined style. Talk to me about your look.
It's very difficult to define who you are. Can you do that? It's not easy. You're always questioning who you are. And I think a part of being alive and being creative is to be unsatisfied by who you are. So I'm not very good at defining myself. You know, when you have to fill a form and say, what do you do? I have a blank moment saying, what do I do actually? I'm an editor. I'm also an art critic in a way still. I was not anymore, and then I'm coming back to writing. I start to do photography. I'm editing a magazine. I'm an art director sometimes to make money. And the way I dress is extremely simple. You know, it's like a uniform for every day. I like to wear jeans and leather jacket and that's it, and boots. Fashion is the enemy for a man. Mm. When you become too obsessed by fashion as a man, you lose time and energy for nothing. You, unless you're a true dandy, and I'm obviously not.
I'm interested, you know, your parents, they were university professors, weren't they? Do you remember when you first became interested in fashion? Was that something that was around you when you were growing up?
I come from the 70s, I'm born in 63, so I've been a young teenager in the 70s, and fashion in the 70s was not a commerce, it was the way people dressed and expressed themselves. This is the way I remember it. In a way, I liked fashion and I hate fashion at the same time. In the 70s, my interest for fashion wasn't identified like that. It was connected to the way people were trying to change their life and change society, or change their own vision of what we could do together. So I was very impressed by the friends of my parents, where they were coming home. I was looking at them. I was sometimes falling in love with older women, you know. I was a little boy, and I was like impressed by older ladies because they were wearing like eccentric dress, funny dress. And they also love. At the time, my parents were nudist. You say nudist in English?
Yeah.
So we had a big garden, and they were like end up naked in the garden. That was really beautiful. It was. I think it's the source of my source of interest in fashion, because I could tell that fashion was a way to express a certain freedom. And when people have a good style and a different way of dressing, they necessarily are different or interesting, something like that. But it was as a kid, I was really impressed and I loved it. In the 80s, I start to hate it. Fashion became, for me, it was the enemy. The solution was the art.
When you started doing purple, I think a lot of people commented that it seemed quite anti-fashion. I think particularly because of the style of photography that you were championing in it. Is that what you wanted it to be? Did you want it to feel different? Did you want it to feel like it was almost the antithesis of what was going on in the fashion industry?
In the beginning of the 90s, we had to kill fashion to like it again, because fashion turned to be extremely bad. So we had to be anti-fashion to celebrate fashion. That was as simple as that.
It's interesting to me that you started a magazine, because you talk about style and you talk about, you know, your love for fashion. It feels like there's a lot of different things you could have done, but you started a magazine. And I guess I want to understand where your love of magazines came from, because I read an interview done before, you said when you were a kid it came from like stealing porn magazines and looking at them. Is that right?
That's right, yes.
Talk to me about that.
The porn magazine, when you were a kid, when you were 10, in the beginning of the 70s, was a real experience. That was really a shock. Today it doesn't mean anything. Pornography is dead. it's not that I regret it, but pornographic doesn't mean anything anymore. You know, and sometimes when I see some, there's still some porn magazine exist. You know, there's still, you can still find some porn magazine in bookshelf. It's really totally pathetic. You really wonder who is buying this, those kind of magazine today.
Mm.
But anyway, in the late 70s and beginning of the 80s, you know, we were. And it's still the case now, I guess. For the new generation, a magazine is a direct way to express yourself. It's a most inexpensive way to say something to the world, or to your friends, which is the world. It's easy to do a magazine. What you need is the energy, and to believe in something. But once you believe in something, and at the beginning of the 90s, it was really easy because all our friends, we were part of a new generation of in everything, in cinema, in writing, in music. It was an emerging generation, like it was everywhere, and it was good. So we were like convinced. We knew that we were right. We knew that this was the right artist, this was the right filmmaker, this was the right designer. And it wasn't in the press, it wasn't everywhere. And we knew these people because we would like meet them by traveling, by meeting them at night, by rumor, by friends. So it was super easy. Today, everything is accessible immediately. As soon as there's a new G.W. Anderson, everyone knows about him, and I'm not the first to know, maybe the last to know now.
Why do you think Purple did work? Why do you think people liked it? Why do you think it was successful?
I think, honestly, it's because of my girlfriend at the time, who was very serious and who said, Olivier, you do a magazine just with me, not with your other friend, because with my friend, we were always fighting and split after a while. So you do it with me, I'm the boss, and you work for me. And she was very serious. Hélène, she forced me to get organized. And she said, you stop working with your friends, you work with me. We work with artists, we don't work with art critic or journalists, we work with artists, we do an artist magazine, because artists need to express themselves. We don't need any art critic like yourself. Because she was like anti the blah blah of art critic and journalists. She was like saying the artists should express themselves and we should collaborate with them directly. So none of your friends who are pretentious and who wants the power, who wants the success, and forget all the journalists, all the wannabe famous writer or whatever, they are impossible to work with. We work directly with artists and we work together. So she isolated me from my friends and we create this little fanzine together. Purple was a little fanzine. So it was the beginning, and I believe that without Hélène I would never have done Purple by myself.
Did Purple become more about fashion than you wanted just for the sake of making money?
For the sake of surviving, yes.
Yeah.
As a magazine, because it's a source of advertising. But this is why in 2004, Hélène left me. She said, Olivier, we are becoming too much a fashion magazine, and I don't like fashion anymore. She said to me, Olivier, we were good in the 90s. Now we are bad. We have to stop. Me, I said, okay, let's stop. And then I realized that it's too bad to stop this project. And she let me continue. She said, okay, Olivier, you can continue. But and I changed the name. It was called Purple before, or Purple Prose, it had a different name. And I add fashion, so it's Purple Fashion now. I'm doing the fashion part of this common project that I had with Hélène. And actually, Hélène is still continuing to do a little magazine, Purple Chronique. And it's a very small project that she lives now in a small village in the countryside in France. And it's more a literature magazine.
Mm.
So she, there's no money, she doesn't make any money, she cultivates her own vegetables. She lives literally with no money. And she has a little daughter, and she now she's refusing the whole system. She's totally anti-fashion now.
It's like quite different to how you live and like the people radical. You're friends with. Tell me about, you're fine with fashion now, aren't you? Because it seems to be a huge part of your life. Fashion parties, models.
But fashion has changed a lot, you know. The year 2000, fashion become a sort of cultural industry where involving artists, involving musicians, involving DJ. So fashion takes more space in our life, in the life of everyone today. You know, in the 90s, people didn't go to fashion shows. Just people who liked fashion. It was you had like 10 people trying to enter Margiela show. That's it, without ticket. Mm. So and now fashion shows, people wants to see it like a, I don't know. Fashion is becoming part of our life, and also it took. I'm not different. It takes more space in my life, for sure. And I love the energy of fashion. I like everything about fashion in a way. Even the commerce of it. I'm. It's a surprising world, but it's also sometimes very depressing because it's empty also.
Purple. It's not just about fashion. It's about sex and bodies and love. Mm. Talk to me about why you see sex and fashion as so sort of interlinked.
To me, fashion is more an attitude, and it's the way you live. And fashion doesn't stop at what you buy in a shop. It's everything. It's like the way you decorate your apartment. It's the way you cut your hair. It's the way you travel. It's the way you speak. It's everything. It's an escape. And when it comes to nudity and to sex, it's the same thing. It's an escape from everyday life or from what we are supposed to do. So to me, it's connected. This is why the most beautiful fashion pictures are naked pictures. It's fantastic. It's a dream of it's like a sculpture. It's a pure dream of beauty, and the attitude is very important. The way in a fashion picture, and especially in a nude picture, in a fashion context, everything, every detail is the way you place the arm, the attitude of the body, the way the model looks. And it's interesting to see how this vocabulary of nudity in fashion is dated from like generation to generation. Even year after year, you know, sometimes I can tell you sometimes this is a picture from 73, this is a nude from 92, this is a nude from 2005. I can tell you, you know, just by the nudity, because it's a vocabulary. Mm. And it's very interesting to continue to see this history, the strength of fashion is that it's all about the body language in a way. It's the way we express our time through our body, mm-hmm. and not only through our clothes, also through our real body. For the, you know, every detail is important. Shave, not shave, every detail. Mm-hmm. Makeup, no makeup, too much makeup, what kind of makeup, what kind of pose, what kind of sexiness, what kind of legs, what kind of ass, what kind of everything makes. So it's semiology in a way. It's like you see how times fly.
Some people would say that the images that they see in purple they'd say they're seedy, or worse, they'd say they're sexist. Do you find that frustrating? Do you think they are sexist?
Some people see purple as sexist. I don't know these people. Maybe they exist, yes, but For sure, as soon as you take a picture of or publish a picture of a naked woman, you're sexist because the feminists consider that you objectify the body. So I have nothing to say against that. It's, to me, it's just stupid, you know. Women are just extremely beautiful, and playing with their body is being a woman.
Do you think the problem is that the women in your magazine look different? You know, they're more naked, they're in more provocative poses than the men. Do you think that's why people find it?
It's not because they're more naked. It's because they're more real. If you do a very theatrical like scenery, and you put a naked woman with all the artificiality of fashion, then people will accept that, this kind of nudity, and won't consider that it's sexist because they're impressed by the artificiality of fashion imagery. And they think, oh, this is art, this is beautiful. This. And in Purple, Purple is more interested in shooting the real person, or we are closer to the subject. It's more real. So the nudity is maybe more shocking. Something like that. We don't protect ourselves with this artificiality of the fashion imagery. And this is also the problem that Terry Richardson has, because the way he shoot a woman is direct. You know, it's like the flash, just a camera, a flash, nothing else. And some people can see that more as more aggressive or more trash, but I see that as more real. I see this kind of picture as more interesting. The same thing with Jürgen Teller. I believe that I prefer this kind of photography because I can really feel the person. I can see the emotion of the person. I can relate to what's going on there. So
it's closer.
It's more personal. So then people are maybe shocked, because if you see a topless girl in this kind of picture, she's more herself. So feminist translate, she's more abused. Or she's more under the influence of the editor or the photographer. No, she's there because she likes her body, she likes to be herself, she's not afraid, she's on the contrary, she's a strong girl.